My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, today is the Maundy Thursday, a day of special significance for all the Catholics all over the world. For today, we recall the three great acts of Jesus Christ. The first is the institution of the Holy Eucharist. The second is the establishment of the ministerial priesthood. And the third is the washing of the feet, that is Christ's commandment to love and to serve. Maundy Thursday in the past days was also known to be a day of reconciliation. For on this day, those guilty of sins were reconciled to the church and to one another. After having spent the season of Lent in prayer and penance, Maundy Thursday also means that evening Jesus gave the new commandment, Novum Mandatum in Latin, which means new commandment. Christ urges us to love one another as I have loved you. Let me elaborate all the three acts which are significant for today's occasion of the Maundy Thursday. The first is the Christ commandment of love and to serve. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, according to the Jewish custom, any guest who enters the home of the host, he was welcomed by the washing of the feet. And the washing of the feet was done by a slave or a servant. Jesus breaks the tradition and instead washes the feet of his disciples. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. Philippians 2:7. Through this humble act of service, of washing of his disciples' feet, Jesus wanted to teach his disciples a lesson that no service is superior or inferior, but service is the very characteristic of our Christian life. Through this humble act of washing of the feet, Jesus wanted to teach his disciples a lesson on what authority is all about. What is authority? Authority is to place oneself, the one who is in authority, under whom, over whom, those who he has authority. I am in authority, but under me there are people working as my subordinates. The real sense of authority for Jesus is, I must place myself in humble service to those who are under me. This concept of authority was quite different in the time of Jesus during the Jewish custom. When the scribes and the Pharisees insisted on the places of honor and attention all through their lives. Not only the scribes and the Pharisees, even his own disciple Peter refuses Christ to wash his feet. Why? Because his concept of authority is very much different. For Jesus, the concept of authority is quite different from the people of his time. The problem for us today, my dear brothers and sisters, is Many of us are living in the realm of Peter, who did not want Jesus to wash his feet. We want others to serve us. We don't want ourselves to serve others. This is quite different from what Jesus understood that evening when he washed his disciples' feet. Jesus gives a challenge to all of us today, to all the Christians, and more so to the leaders of the church. Authority is you give yourself in service to others. As I have come to serve and not to be served, and to give my life in abundance for others. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, let me quote to you Holy Father Pope Francis, who is known for his act of humility and service. What he says about love, the first commandment, and what he says about service to others. Pope Francis was celebrating the Eucharist on 21st of May 2013, the very first year of his papacy. And he was celebrating his Eucharist in the chapel of Casa Santa Marta in the Vatican City. And who were the audiences? Who were the people, congregation, who had come for that mass? The congregation was not simple people. Vice President and the President of the Focolare movement, Director of the famous magazine Civilita Cattolica, Director of the magazine La Osservato Romano, the official bulletin of the Vatican City, and many other officials of the Vatican City. And Pope was preaching to them on service. What does the Pope say? He says, church has no room for power struggles. In the church, the greatest is the one who serves the most. And the one who is at the service of others, he is the greatest. And the gospel for that day, for the mass which the Holy Father had, was Mark chapter 9. If you remember, the apostles are going, and on their way, they are discussing among themselves, who is the greatest among us? And Jesus catches them. Jesus tells them, the greatest among you is the one who serves. And Pope Francis says, power struggles must not exist, because the true power is which the Lord has taught us, the power in service. And he gives the examples. He says, when any of our friends have been raised to a high status, gets promotion, what we say, he or she has been raised to the status of being a president of the association. She got a promotion, he got a promotion, I too should have got the promotion. And the Holy Father says, Pope Francis, you want promotion? You want promotion? Look at the cross. He was promoted to the crucifixion. He was promoted to utter humiliation. He says, this is what we must do in our lives. Not crave for power, not crave for honors, but simple act of Christ, who was promoted to the cross in utter humiliation. And he says further, authority is what makes us to be more like Jesus Christ. If you and I do not understand this Christian rule today, then we will never understand Christ's message on love and service to one another. The real power, Pope Francis says, is what Jesus did for others. He served others and he gave his life for others. My dear brothers and sisters, once again, Pope Francis says on power and those who are struggling for power in the church. He says, thinking of being great paralyzes the church. Triumphalism in the church impedes the church. Triumphalism among the Christian impedes the Christians. Pope warned Christians all over the world of looking out for a church that looks for power, that looks for promotions. He says, choose the path that Jesus chose, the path of the Holy Cross, which in the eyes of the world might be a failure, but that is the path that Jesus chose, a path of love. In humble service, he died on the cross. This is the first act, Christ's commandment of love one another in humble service to one another. My dear brothers and sisters, the second act is the institution of the Holy Eucharist. In the year 2003, if you remember, we celebrated the centenary of the invention of the first aeroplane by the Wright brothers. This invention has contributed in great deal to the development of the modern world. Travel has become much faster and quicker. But my dear brothers and sisters, as the Wright brothers were going through the agony of inventing or producing their first invention, the airplane, these Wright brothers were ridiculed by many. They were mocked by many. Many of his own friends made fun of them when they heard of this invention. Many, including their own father, ridiculed his Wright brothers because they thought it was next to impossible for men to travel in the sky by aeroplane. The story of the Wright brothers is not an isolated one. There are many inventors in the past who have been ridiculed, who have been mocked when they first came with their inventions or discoveries. Some have been even branded as insane, mad, foolish. We may wonder, my dear brothers and sisters, what made those people to ridicule the inventors, to make fun of them? One sure answer could be their inventions were beyond the comprehension of the ordinary human being of that time. They could not understand. They could not understand. It was beyond their imagination, beyond their comprehension of the ordinary human beings. Think of the institution of the Holy Eucharist, my dear brothers and sisters. Jesus is at the table. He takes the bread, blesses it, gives it to his disciples and says, "Take, eat, this is my body." Similarly, he does with the cup, the chalice of his wine. He blesses it and gives it to the disciples saying, "Take, drink, this is my blood." We don't know how the apostles reacted at that time. Perhaps, like those people who ridiculed the inventors, Wright brothers, they may have also mocked or made fun among themselves what this man is doing. Because if you read John chapter 6 verse 28, the Bread of Life discourse, there when Jesus speaks about his own flesh and blood, the apostles murmur. They don't agree to that. Some of them get up and go away. This is a foolish man. He is a fool. How can he give us his own flesh and blood to drink? Jesus, my dear brothers and sisters, that night did something very ordinary, something very plain, something very shocking. When he told them, "Eat, this is my body. Drink, this is my cup." And later on, he got up, washed their feet, and he told them to do, "Now you do the same what I have done." My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, Creator God washing the feet of his creatures, which the disciples did not understand. It was beyond their comprehension. It was beyond their imagination. This is something God was doing, never heard of or never seen. What he was doing, it was showing God was deeply, madly in love with humanity. He was giving his self gift. My dear brothers and sisters, Saint Alfonso Liguori says, love gone mad, love gone mad. God was deeply in mad with his people. So he was giving his own self gift. People then and even now, my dear brothers and sisters, we are yet to understand the selfless self gift of Jesus in the Holy Eucharist. What is Holy Eucharist? What is Holy Eucharist? In the year 2004 and 5, Pope Saint John Paul II declared that year as the year of the Eucharist. And he came up with the encyclical. What was the encyclical? Mane Nobis Cum Domine. Mane Nobis Cum Domine in Latin means stay with us, Lord. And what did the Pope say in that encyclical on Eucharist? Eucharist is the source and mission of the life of the church. Eucharist is the source of the life and mission of the church. We must celebrate the Holy Eucharist decorously, meaningfully. Take it to our lives. And he says, by this, two objectives will be accomplished. First, we will learn to give importance to our daily Eucharist, including the Sunday Eucharist. We will also intensify our love for the presence of Jesus in the Adoration Chapel in the Blessed Sacrament. Secondly, my dear brothers and sisters, once again, Pope Saint John Paul II came up with another apostolic exhortation, Ecclesia de Eucharistia. Ecclesia de Eucharistia, in that he says, Eucharist is the church's treasure, most powerful treasure. And it is the heartbeat of the world, which keeps the world alive. It is the Eucharist. Every man and woman, consciously and unconsciously, desires to receive the Holy Eucharist and receive that healing that they need. My dear brothers and sisters, there is a little story about a young boy, a small boy. A small boy was living in the orphanage run by the sisters in their convent. There were some sisters running the orphanage. And this boy was an orphan boy. But the sisters in the convent noticed something very unique in this boy. This boy was wearing a cap all the time. He was wearing a cap. For his meals, he was with the cap. While he was go to the school in the classrooms, he was with the cap. While he was having his dinner, he was with the cap. The only time he would remove his cap was while he was having his bath. Soon after cleaning himself, he would again wear the cap. Even while sleeping at night, he would sleep with the cap on. The sisters and the others were finding it very strange why this boy was wearing cap. Umpteen times they told him to take it off, but he would not listen. Finally, when he was about to leave the orphanage, when he had finished his studies, his course, he mentioned to the sisters saying, sisters, when I was a little boy, my mother, before dying, she cut a little piece of a sari and she tied it for the cap inside. And she said, son, whenever you wear this cap and look at the piece of the sari inside which I have tied it, remember me. Remember me. That is the Eucharist, my dear brothers and sisters. Whenever we celebrate the Holy Eucharist, do this in memory of me. We remember that act which Christ instituted on the Maundy Thursday that evening. Wherever the Eucharist is celebrated, do this in memory of me. We remember the great act of Christ that he celebrated the first Eucharist and gave it for all of us. My dear brothers and sisters, I need to pose few questions before you for our practical understanding and for our practical thinking and answering this question for yourself. Let us ask, how prayerful are we when we come to celebrate the Holy Eucharist? What goes on in my mind as I come in a queue to receive the Holy Eucharist? What goes on in my mind after I have received my Holy Eucharist and I go back to my place? Do I remain there for a while and pray, talk to Jesus who has come into my heart? Or do I think something else? Am I conscious, am I aware the living presence of Jesus is going to come into my heart? That Jesus has to touch me. Am I talking to Jesus? Am I listening to Jesus? St. Paul very beautifully says that we need to examine our conscience before we come to celebrate each Eucharist. And my dear brothers and sisters, the Holy Eucharist, the communion, really builds up our intimacy and relationship with the Lord. Does the Holy Eucharist build up my relationship with the Lord? Is my relationship with the Lord becoming stronger day by day when I receive the Holy Eucharist, or it is getting weaker day by day? If it is getting weaker, why? If it is getting stronger, yes. Eucharist is where I receive healing for my wounds that have been caused by sin. Pope Francis very beautifully says, Church is the hospital in the battlefield of the world, where those wounded come and experience God's divine mercy in Eucharist and in the other sacraments. Does this Eucharist help me to receive healing for my wounded souls, for my sins that I have committed? We need to ask yourself. Eucharist is the body broken to strengthen us as a community. Is this my Sunday experience and other days experience? Do I feel myself strengthened by the breaking of the body and blood for me in the Holy Eucharist? Do I feel strengthened? Or do I go home? Do we go home more as betrayals and hurt feelings due to lack of sensitivity? We need to answer these questions for ourselves. Let us pray, my dear brothers and sisters, each time that we celebrate the Eucharist, we may experience the healing presence of Christ, the healing touch of Christ in our Holy Eucharist. The third act, my dear brothers and sisters, in Jesus Christ is the institution of the ministerial priesthood. The institution of the ministerial priesthood. Jesus knew very well that his mission is not going to last because he'll be crucified. In order to continue the mission which his father had entrusted to him, he established the holy priesthood. The mission has to go on. The priesthood he established so that his mission has to be carried on by someone. He instituted the priesthood, my dear brothers and sisters, and till today, the priest, in communion with the bishop, continue the mission of Christ by celebrating the Holy Eucharist and the other sacraments. Let me quote to you St. John Mary Vianney, the patron of the pastors. Priest is not a priest for himself. He is for you. After God, the priest is everything. My dear brothers and sisters, today is the feast of all the priests all over the world, priest of your church and priest all over the world. Today is the day every priest will realize and will think that his hands have been consecrated with the chrism oil on the day of his ordination. Father Johnson will very well remember 22 years ago, Bishop Philip Neri, Archbishop of Goa, anointed his hands with the holy oil of chrism. Father Dilip will remember several years ago, in the year 2008, his hands were anointed with the chrism oil by Bishop Edwin Colasso. I remember today, 21 years ago, Bishop Bosco Peña anointed my hands with the chrism oil. It's a day for us to remember. And very shortly, Deacon Marcelino will also remember when he will be ordained by Bishop Bartol Barreto, his hands will be consecrated, anointed with the oil of the chrism. My dear brothers and sisters, priest is not for himself, priest is for you. After God, the priest is for you. The priest is everything for you. Who is a priest? A priest is a true disciple of Christ, who does not know most, but he loves the most. He loves the most. My dear brothers and sisters, it is easy to become a priest, but it is very hard to remain happy and to be fulfilled during through our lives. A priest is a mediator between God and man. He brings God to man and he takes man back to God. Priest is not for himself, for he is the servant of God. Pope Francis once again reminds all the priests, a priest is called to serve. Serve his church. Serve the people. Not to make money or not to build his career. Priest is called to serve. A priest is not his own, but he belongs to Christ. He is the one who proclaims, Ubi Lux, Ubi Deus. Where there is light, there is God. Pope Benedict XVI, he gives the example of St. John Mary Vianney. He says, St. John Mary Vianney was a man from whose life people learned how to pray. They learned from his life, not from his words. His life was an exemplary for the people. The priestly identity, my dear brothers and sisters, is edified and renewed through our total communion with the Lord. A priest is called to be holy. A priest is called to be Altus Christus, another Christ. A priest is called to be Emmanuel, God with us. People must experience the presence of God when there is a priest amidst them. That's what Pope St. John Paul II says. Priest is called to be Altus Christus, priest is called to be holy, and priest is called to be Emmanuel. Priest, my dear brothers and sisters, is not divine. He is a human being. He is chosen from among you, and he is set apart for his greater mission. Priest is not infallible. Priest is bound to make mistakes. Correct your priest. Let there be fraternal corrections. Don't criticize them. Pray for them. Pray for them. They have their own weaknesses. They have their own limitations. Therefore, for our practical applications, what shall we take? Pray for the priest that he becomes a man of God. Man of God. Let me give you one example. There was a little boy, young boy, Narendra. He wanted to see God. He wanted to see God. So he went to different people and asked, can you show me God? Can you show me God? Different people gave different answers, but he was not happy about it. Finally, he went to a priest. He went to a priest and he asked him, can you show me God? And the priest confidently said, yes, I have seen God. And I will show God to you too. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, priest is called to be a man of God. He has to experience God and share his experience to others. Pray today in a special way. Priest may become a man of God. He remains in close union with God. Pray that your priest, all the priests all over the world, may strip themselves of worldliness, may strip themselves of vanity and shallowness. Pope Francis very beautifully says, it is ridiculous that any priest, any bishop, any cardinal, or even the Pope, if he is worldly. Worldliness kills. It kills the person, it kills the soul, it kills the spirit of the church. The priest is not supposed to be worldly, but he must have a Christ-like attitude. Worldliness, Pope Francis says, is idolatry. Priest must not be worldly, but holy after the sacred heart of Jesus. So pray that your priest all over the world may strip themselves of worldliness, vanity and shallowness. Third, Saint Teresa of Avila, contemplative saint, she says, behind every priest there is a devil that is fighting for his downfall. My dear brothers and sisters, pray that our priest may never fall into any temptations. Temptations can be lack of conviction. Certain things can creep in, human as we are, lack of conviction that I am a priest, or lack of prayer life in myself. Behind every priest, there is a devil fighting for his downfall. Pray that such laxities may not creep into the priest. Pray for this intention. Another temptation could be whiling away the time, inappropriate relationships, unintegrated sexuality, addictions, compulsions. These are all the things that can lead to the downfall of the priest. Pray that this may never happen. Pray that he may be in Christ and with Christ and for Christ. Finally, my dear brothers and sisters, pray for the gift of the vocation. We need priest. We need priest for funerals. We need priest to bless our marriages. We need priest to bless our homes. We need priest to lay the foundation stones of our new buildings. We need priest for counseling. We need priest for confessions. We need priest to celebrate the Holy Eucharist. This only priest can do. Pray that Christ's commandment, "Do this in memory of me," may fall onto the ears of many of our youngsters, that they may answer their call to the priesthood. My dear brothers and sisters, let us today pray for ourselves, pray for one another. Let us learn to serve one another, taking into mind Christ's commandment of love one another as I have loved you. Comes also the service. We are called to be at the service of others. That is the authority. Secondly, let us learn to value the Holy Eucharist, the real presence of Christ, each time that we come to celebrate the Holy Eucharist. And let us also pray for all our priests all over the world, that they may be with Christ, that they may be in Christ, and they may remain for Christ. Amen.